I'm going to let you know that I'm a palliative care physician. I am not a urologist or an oncologist or a radiation oncologist, but it is my pleasure for the last many years to work with the rest of the folks that you've been seeing today, and really my honor to talk about androgen deprivation and how we mediate the effects of androgen deprivation, how we manage the toxicity. So I think about the adverse effects of androgen deprivation and treatment as including the side effects of the medicine itself, the possibility that the medicine may create increased risks for other diseases, or it may actually result in the development of other diseases. So we'll be talking about all of those. And there's three main adverse effects that I want to discuss today. One is cardiovascular effects. This is, for some, a life or death issue. Heart disease is the number one cause of death in the United States. Yeah, it is not cancer. It is not COVID. It is heart disease. So heart disease is a serious issue. We can think about heart disease being mediated in the context of prostate cancer treatment through weight gain that we sometimes see, changes in lipids or your cholesterol, and worsening insulin resistance, which is the mechanism for diabetes. The amount of heart disease that develops in the context of androgen deprivation treatment is not totally clear, not totally precise, but perhaps around 20% of excess cardiac morbidity associated with androgen deprivation. Now, importantly, that's not been shown in all studies, so there's still more work to be done here. But suffice it to say, for most men, the risk could be significant and something to pay attention to and certainly to be thinking about and monitoring. The effects of cardiovascular risk could be mediated through hypertension, show up as hypertension, as heart attacks, as fatal arrhythmias, as stroke. So much so, this is such a common issue in oncology these days that there is a sub-specialty called cardiac oncology that you have specialists who are cardiologists with really advanced and particular knowledge around dealing with cardiac risk factors for people being treated for cancer. The second big risk is hormonal. We've heard some of this already today. It includes osteoporosis, decreased bone density, loss of muscle mass causing weakness, breast enlargement, which is quite common and can be associated with pain, and hot flashes, which is very, very common. Almost 30% of men might report hot flashes as the number one worst symptom that they've experienced as a result of androgen deprivation. The third and important group of side effects, of the adverse effects that I wanted to talk about are, I would label under the category of vitality. I hear this very, very frequently from men who talk about not just feeling the same, experiencing a loss of vitality, a word that I often hear. And this can include fatigue, very commonly the number one complaint that people report in the context of their cancers. It can result in, androgen deprivation can result in sleep disturbance, low libido, loss of interest in sex. So this is different than erectile function. This is loss of interest in it, desire for sex, so much so that approximately 70% of men on androgen deprivation report that they've stopped having sex. We've also heard a little bit today about the potential for loss of size, decreased size of the penis and the testes. And then importantly, and this is something that some men traditionally have had difficulty even thinking about or talking about or admitting, which is the risk for increased emotionality. That's when you're crying because of a commercial that you saw on TV, something you never have done before, but all of a sudden you find yourself tearing up around a Kleenex commercial or something like that. Yeah. And then depression, which is a real disease that many in this room likely have experienced, regardless of whether or not you've been on androgen deprivation. It is a common experience for people and increased risk in the context of androgen deprivation. So we heard right at the very beginning of the day from Eric Small about weighing the different strategies for dealing with this. So if androgen deprivation is causing side effects, you can try and take less androgen deprivation therapy, and that might be appropriate. And you've heard throughout the day all sorts of research really aimed at trying to minimize harmful treatments, difficult, burdensome treatments, to maximize and maximize benefits. But if androgen deprivation is going to be part of your regimen, the other alternative, the other strategy is to really think about how to minimize, mitigate the side effects. And that's what we're going to be talking about for the next couple of minutes. So management occurs in sort of two flavors. One is medicines, which I'm going to get to in just a moment. That's what I do a lot of, prescribe a lot of, and like to talk about, but I'm going to really be focusing in on something that's super important, which is behavioral interventions. And the reason that these are so important is because they are safe, something that I cannot claim for every medication that I might prescribe. They all have risks. So these are safe and they are very effective. And we're going to go into cognitive behavioral therapy and physical activity as interventions, but I just wanted to show you this chart that shows that there are a few things that can have lots of different effects. So lots of benefits from one intervention. So let's talk about physical activity. I know you heard some about that already. And if I could encourage all of us to do one thing in our lives, prostate cancer or not, it would be to exercise more. Motion is lotion. Exercise has been proven so helpful for so many things. And in fact, in the context of androgen deprivation side effects, physical activity has been shown to be effective for fatigue, the best intervention we have for fatigue, for sexual function, for overall quality of life, for metabolic syndrome and cardiovascular fitness, incontinence, bone health, and muscle strength, right? So kind of good for what ails you. So exercise, exercise, exercise. We talk about 150 minutes per week, so about 20, 21, 22 minutes a day. Yeah, so not that much. Once you get yourself to exercise, most people find some satisfaction with that and then can increase the amount of time that they're doing it. So it's really about sort of just getting it done, just starting it, yeah. So we want aerobic exercise. We want you to be breathing a little bit extra hard. And we want to think about resistance and weightlifting. We just heard about how exercise, Kegels, other kinds of exercise require the effort, the work against weight. Yeah. So both are important, resistance training as well as aerobic exercise. The second big behavioral intervention for androgen deprivation related side effects is cognitive behavioral therapy. Again, sort of a multimodal, a multi-effect from CBT, commonly the acronym for cognitive behavioral therapy, improving fatigue, depression, sleep, possibly also for the side effects of hot flashes and sexual health. So CBT stems from the idea that we get emotions because of things, we have emotional reactions to things, and then there are the complexities of what we think about our feelings, but what our thoughts are about our feelings, and then what we do, our behaviors. So it's the idea that you start off with an emotion, and then there are responses that have to do with how you think about it. Yeah. So those interrelationships happen as well, so that we can see that behavior can change our thinking and our emotions, and our thoughts can create feelings as well. So there's this very, very interesting, profound interrelationship between thoughts, our behaviors, as well as our emotions, and they can go back and forth. And so cognitive behavioral therapy is a form of talk therapy that helps get control of these relationships and sort of correct where there's errors in that process, in those interrelationships that can help you do better. Meaning, if you are feeling fear, but that fear is causing you not to exercise, can we change the thought about your emotion, about your fear, so that you can feel good about exercise and get the exercise done that will help with your symptoms? So the thing about CBT that's really powerful is that it's short-term. that it's very goal-oriented, and as a result, it's covered by insurance. Yeah, but it's hard. It takes a lot of work. Like most good things, to see the effect, you're gonna have to put in some of the energy. And so CBT is famous for giving you homework. So you'll meet with a therapist, talk about these things, and then you'll have to work. You'll have to practice. You'll have to develop your skills so that you can overcome some of these side effects. Finding a therapist who does CBT can be hard. You can go to psychologytoday.com and enter your zip code and your insurance information, and they'll help you find someone. And we also have good data that doing CBT over telemedicine, meaning over Zoom or a video visit, can be effective as well. So again, my push is really to think about exercise, to think about CBT. There are also lots of medicines. There's lots of medicines you can try, and that can be very effective as well. So Terry Friedlander talked about bone health, and we talked about sort of the diagnosis with the Dixit scan, and he talked about the treatment with various medications. So I'm gonna skip through there and suffice to say, this is super, super important, and that we have really good treatments. And avoiding bone fracture due to thinning bones is really, really important. So let's go on to other things that have medicines that can help. First and foremost, I wanted to talk about depression. Depression is something that we have medicines that can be helpful, but the combination of talk therapy and medication is probably the most effective of all the interventions that you can think of. So when we think about medicine interventions for depression, we're talking about antidepressants, sort of the classic serotonin reuptake inhibitors and serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, the SSRIs and SNRIs. Hot flashes. Again, behavior is key here. Lifestyle interventions can be very, very important. Acupuncture may even be effective, but you can think about some other things. So first on the list, as it turns out, happen to be antidepressants. So you can get a double benefit from your antidepressant potentially. Venlafaxine, paroxetine are two that have been shown in trials to be effective, but probably it's a class effect across the SSRIs and SNRIs. Gabapentin is a medicine that can help for pain. It was originally developed for seizures, but we almost use it exclusively these days. For pain management and for the control of hot flashes. So another medicine that you can think of. Oxybutynin, a medicine that can help with incontinence, another medicine that can be useful. New on the block is Feosa, which has been developed for women with hot flashes in the setting of breast cancer treatment. It hasn't really been studied well in men. So if you see an opportunity to be part of a clinical trial for Feosa, give it a try, because Feosa can be super, super effective. And then we heard very much, very early in the day about estrogen as being effective, topical estrogen in particular. So that's on the list as well. Importantly, cardiovascular risk. One of the main points I want to make about cardiovascular risk is that you should be thinking about assessing cardiovascular risk early, essentially within a few months of starting androgen deprivation treatment, because we can see some of the effects on cardiovascular risk factors affecting men within just 3 to 6 months of starting androgen deprivation. So we can think about controlling hypertension with antihypertensive medicines. We can think about controlling cholesterol with anti-cholesterol medicines, Lipitor as the classic one. Yeah, aspirin as a prophylactic medicine may be indicated. And then there's interventional cardiology with stents and other things that cardiologists may do. So it may be that if you have no cardiovascular disease, doing monitoring, talking about this with your oncologist, typically your primary care physician, may be sufficient. If you already have cardiovascular disease, which many people will, really, really being in coordination with your cardiologist to pay attention to rising risk factors for cardiovascular disease is important. Fatigue is, as I said, a symptom that is best treated with exercise, and I get it. You're tired, you may not want to get up and get out and go do exercise, but it's really important to do. We also have some medicines that may make sense for you a stimulant medicine called methylphenidate. Some people have used, or whose kids have used it for attention deficit disorder, with a medicine that's a methylphenidate called Ritalin. So that can be useful. And again, another plug for antidepressants for those of us who are dealing with depression. And there are some antidepressants that are activating that might be useful for fatigue. And then finally, sleep, improving sleep through various behavioral strategies. CBTI, cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia, is probably the most effective and useful in the long term. And then melatonin may be useful as well. My take-home point, though, is all of this has to be determined and discussed with you, among you, your loved ones and partners who may be involved, and with your physicians and clinical teams. So that's your oncologist, your radiation oncologist, your surgeons, and folks like me if you're engaged with palliative care, to try and figure out how to match your goals with the right treatments, the right interventions that might help you achieve those goals. This is a difficult decision. It's a complex decision that affects so many parts of your life. So none of us have the single expertise to make these decisions ideally. We as patients are expert in ourselves, but there are clinicians that are expert in medicines, that are expert in procedures, that can really help sort out these decisions. And I would point out that these decisions are influenced by so many things, including your prognosis, how long you expect to be living, what other diseases you're dealing with, and the prognoses of those diseases. And then ultimately, to remember that your preferences are likely to change over time. The decisions you might have made when you were 20 are not the same decisions you might make when you're 40 or 60 or 80 or 100. Yeah. So you learn over time. You learn what matters to you and what doesn't matter to you. What matters to you and doesn't matter to you changes over time. Yeah. And your experience of side effects may really change things. I have a lot of people who tell me, you know, if I develop X, Y, or Z symptom, I'm going to stop treatment because I couldn't stand to have X, Y, or Z symptom. And then when they develop that symptom, perhaps later on, they say to me, you know what? It's not as bad as I thought it was. I can live with that because there are other things that are going on in my life that matter to me. So really, really just another plug for shared decision-making to really, really focus on what matters to you currently and how you want to weigh the benefits and the burdens of various treatment decisions.